Well, good morning, everyone. It's always great to be here. A couple of announcements here for us this morning, for us to know. The screens up here, they might go out during our worship service, but no worries. We have it all under control, according to Jeremy, okay? So no worries about that. Another thing is that we do have the membership forms and lists outside in the Narthex. Please take a look at that if there's any missing information, incorrect information, or something like that. Please feel free to just make those corrections. If your name is not on the list, add your name to it. We are planning to make a directory here by the end of September. So please take a look at that. Make sure all the information is correct. What was that? Yeah. Yeah, just new information this time around. So we're not going to take photos. Yeah, so we'll put that together. And then we have the Cal Nevada Ministry Revival in Clovis on the 28th. We will be having our two combined worship services each month during the first and second Sundays. And yeah, are there any other announcements at this time? Thank you.
Patty also asked that we come in the front door rather than going around the side because there's no handrail for the steps. If we come to the house, it'll be much simpler. So, and yes, they're cooking barbecued short ribs. So we just bring stuff to go with it. I also wanted to mention that we have a need for hostesses and for greeters for this next year, next month, September, which starts next week already. So there's a pen right there. Just put your name down, and I'll get your name in the bulletin. That's the good part, and it's really an excellent way to have a time to chat with everybody too. So please sign up.
Thank you, Alma. Any other announcements? I just want to let us know also that Waher's funeral service will be in Sacramento. I know it's quite a distance from here, but it will be in Sacramento from the 16th to the 18th of September. So the Orville Church, our Hmong congregation, is planning to be there all day on Saturday. So the worship services are usually about 10 o'clock in the morning till about noon, and then they have lunch, and then they kind of have a viewing session after that, and then the evening service is typically around 4 to 6. So if you can make it, that'll be great. If not, so no worries about that. Just let everybody know about that. And so at this time, we have no other announcements, so please stand with me and join me for the call to worship. Jesus said to them, "The light is with you for a little longer. Walk while you have the light, so that the darkness may not overtake you. If you walk in the darkness, you do not know where you are going. While you have the light, believe in the light, so that you may become children of light. Nations shall come to our light, and kings to the brightness of our darkness." Please turn your hymnals to 188, 188, "Christ is the World's Light." pray. Lord, we thank you for this morning, Lord. We thank you for the light, the true light that has come into this world. Your Son, Jesus Christ, who came into the darkness to give us light, to make us see, to give us sight, that we may see the world for what it truly is, Lord. We thank you so much for this. As we come before you this morning, we ask for the Holy Spirit to be present with all of us, giving us the power to be able to worship you with all our hearts and our minds. We give you all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. You may be seated at this time, and it is time for our Old Testament reading.
Our Old Testament reading this morning is from Exodus chapter 27, verse 20 and 21. Instruct the people of Israel to bring you pure olive oil to use in the lamps of the tabernacle, to burn there continually. Aaron and his sons shall place this eternal flame in the outer holy room, tending it day and night before the Lord, so that it never goes out. This is a permanent rule for the people of Israel. The word of our Lord for the people of our Lord.
Please stand with me if you're able to. Turn your hymnals to 170. 170, Oh How I Love Jesus. Amen. You may be seated at this time. It is time for us to share our joys and our concerns. No joys or concerns this morning? Okay.
I have a joy. My son, Brendan, who's been struggling with PTSD, has gotten a full-time job.
Praise the Lord.
Yes, it's wonderful. He's actually doing something he really loves, and he's a project estimator for Metalworks here in Oroville.
That's great.
Yeah, so a lot we've been praying about lately. All right. Thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing that. Anyone else? Okay, let us pray together. Lord, how beautiful you are. How beautiful it is to be able to be in your presence, to worship you. With all of our brothers and sisters this morning, Lord, the family of God called, each of us called by our very own name, to be a part of your church, to be a part of your kingdom, to be a light unto this world, just as Jesus who came into this world to give us light, Lord. We ask that you continue to bless us, continue to be with us, continue to continue to just empower us so that we can represent you in this world, Lord, that we can be a light into our community here, just as your Son is a light unto us, Lord. Lord, we thank you so much for each other. We thank you so much for our church. We thank you so much for your Son, Jesus Christ, the very one who was God himself, and yet he humbled himself. He humbled himself and was born in the flesh to come into this world, to take upon the flesh of men, and to die upon the cross, to suffer for us on that cross, to redeem us as a people, to restore us, to reconcile us back into a relationship with you, Lord. Thank you so much for these things. We'll always be in gratitude for all the things and all the blessings that you have given us, Lord. We thank you for just watching us every day and just guiding us every single day, keeping our fellowship alive, keeping our faith in you at all times, Lord. Even during times in which we may struggle in our faith, you continue to strengthen us. You continue to watch over us, and we thank you so much for these things. We ask that your wisdom always go ahead of us, and that your Son, Jesus Christ, is always the one that's in our hearts, blessing us at all times, Lord. This morning, as we gather here together, we thank you so much, and we praise you for Brandon that was able to find a job, Lord. We praise you for these things. We ask that you continue to be with him, continue to just love him, revealing yourself to him each and every single day, building him up in his faith, to be more and more like your Son, Jesus Christ, each and every single day, just as you're building us up as a church and as individuals here in your church, Lord. And so together we pray the prayer that your Son, Jesus Christ, once taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. It's time for our New Testament reading.
Our New Testament reading is from Matthew chapter 19, verse 13 through 15, and then from John chapter 1, verse 9 through 13. First is Matthew 19. Little children were brought for Jesus to lay his hands on them and pray. But the disciples scolded those who brought them. "Don't bother him," they said. But Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me and don't prevent them, for of such is the kingdom of heaven." And he put his hands on their heads and blessed them before he left. And John chapter 1. Let's see here. Later on, the one who is the true light arrived to shine on everyone coming into the world. But although he made the world didn't recognize him when he came. Even in his own land and among his own people, the Jews, he was not accepted. Only a few would welcome and receive him. But to all who received him, he gave the right to become children of God. All they needed to do was to trust him to save them. All those who believe this are reborn, not of physical rebirth resulting from human passion or plan, but from the will of God. The words of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
What do we mean when we say dead orthodoxy? One of the things that I find out is that oftentimes when we hear terms such as that, there's often a lot of emotional attachment to some of these terms here. And so people often think differently about terms such as this. And we often respond in different ways when we hear words such as these. But I'm going to go off of a more contemporary saying instead of going off that term, dead orthodoxy. A more contemporary way of saying this is saying that we're simply just going through the motions. We're simply going through the motions. And this happens to all of us. Throughout our Christian history, throughout the history of the church, there's been time, many times in the church, in which we are simply just going through the motions of our religious ceremonies, our religious rituals. Throughout the Old Testament, we see the Israelites battling with that very same challenge, that after a while, they're simply just going through the motions of doing all these religious stuff. But this doesn't only happen in the church. It doesn't only happen in our relationship with Jesus Christ, but sometimes it occurs in our marriages when we're simply just going through the motions. Sometimes it happens in our careers. Sometimes it happens in our relationship with our friends, with our family members. Now, if we were to look in Revelation chapter 2, verse 2 to verse 4, we see that Jesus Christ, as he was speaking to the church at Ephesus, we see that the church at Ephesus was going through the very same thing. They were doing all the right things, and yet they have lost their zeal. They have lost their zeal, they have lost their love, they have lost their passion for Jesus Christ. And this is what it reads here in Revelation chapter 2, verse 2 to verse 4 to the Ephesus church. Christ says, "I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked people and that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not and have found them to be false. You have persevered. You have endured hardships for my name. And you have not grown weary, yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first." And so you see, this church here was doing all the right things. They were doing all the right things. They were doing all the religious ceremonies, all the rituals that they had. They're doing all these things. They were practicing their faith. And yet, what Christ was reminding them of is that they have lost their love. They have lost their passion. They have lost their zeal. And Christ is coming back to them, and Christ is reminding this church here at Ephesus that it is time for you to rediscover that zeal for me again. It is time for you to rediscover that passion, that love that you once had for me. And not just go through all the rituals, not just go through all these traditions that you've always done in your church, but to have that love once again. Now, what causes this? What causes us to many times lose our passion in the things that we do? Well, one of the reasons that this happens to us is because we often forget the meaning and the purpose of what we're doing. In other words, we have forgotten the why in our relationships. We have forgotten the why in our marriages. We have forgotten the why in our careers. We have forgotten the why in our friendships. We've forgotten our why in the church, and we've forgotten our why with our Lord Jesus Christ. And like I said, this has happened throughout Christian history. And one of the ways for us to rediscover that is that there's always this awakening, this reawakening, which is basically a time for us to really refocus, to shift our focus back, to rediscover that why. Why is it that we're doing this? And in the Christian faith, we often call these things revival. Christians are Christian revivals. It is time for us to turn back. It is time for us to think about and to rediscover the reason, the purpose, and the meaning behind these things that we do. And so that we're not just simply just doing them. We're not simply just going through the motions of doing these things, but that we understand why it is that we're doing the things that we are doing. Now, oftentimes in the church, we often have different ways of responding to dead orthodoxy, or we have different ways of responding to these issues when we have lost our focus. There are those who often think that we just need to continue doing the things that we are doing. They will not admit that there's anything wrong in the church. They will not be willing to change anything that they're doing. We call these the conservative Christians, right? They never want to change. It's always the same thing every single time. It's always doing these things. But then we also have those who we call the progressive Christians in the church, those who want to reinvent Christianity. And by the time we find out, Christianity is no longer Christianity. And in the church, when we change Christianity so much, we have lost the true meaning of Christianity. We have lost the purpose of Christianity. We have lost the meaning of Christianity. We have lost the foundation of Christianity. Many times we don't know what Christianity is anymore. That's why so many times in the church we don't even believe in the miracles of Jesus Christ anymore because of these things. But I want to present to us that there is a third way. And this is the way that has always revived the church throughout our Christian history. Through the Reformation, it was the rediscovery of faith by grace, the saved by grace. That we are saved by the grace of God. It is a rediscovery of the truth of Scripture. During the days of John Wesley, during the first Great Awakening in Europe and also here in America, it was the rediscovery of the new birth, the warming of Wesley's heart, the conversion experience. Because for so long we've been doing this Christian stuff, and so we just assume that everyone is a Christian. But it was that rediscovery of the conversion experience, the new birth, that gave us the way to the Great Awakening here in America and changed the history of American Christianity. And so, What I want to do today is I want to take us to rediscover the reasons and the why we worship the way that we worship in the Methodist Church. I want us to rediscover the purpose of the Methodist Church. I want us to rediscover why it is that we do these things. What is the purpose? What is the meaning? What is the why behind these things? Now, many times in the contemporary church nowadays, many people claim that they don't have a liturgy or an order of service. But in reality is that everyone has one. But is there a purpose behind that liturgy? Is there a purpose behind that order of service? Many contemporary churches nowadays, they've deserted so much of the liturgy that we use, and they would just come up and start playing rock and roll music and start singing. And once they're done singing, once they get tired and they're done singing and they're done jumping up and down, they'll just hear the pastor preach and they all go home. And they feel that that's the way that we need to worship nowadays. And yet, in the United Methodist Church, we still have a liturgy. We still have this order of service. Now, is there a reason for that? Is there a reason why we do these things? Is there a reason why throughout Christian history we always have an order of service? We always have this Christian liturgy. Well, the reason, the basis for our order of service, the basis for this liturgy, is based out of Acts chapter 42, verse 45. And many churches, many contemporary churches nowadays who are going away from these things, I believe that they are making a mistake because there's no biblical foundation, no biblical basis for the things that they are doing. Now, even though they may experience that emotional experience for a while, it may not be long-lasting. I don't believe that it will be long-lasting for them. Because everything that is eternal is always based on what God has revealed to us. And so the liturgy of the United Methodist Church, the liturgy of the Christian church throughout history, has always found its basis in Acts chapter 42 to verse 45. It says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. And so we find five things here in these passages here. The five things that the Christians did together during the times of the apostles. And John Wesley always believed that the church that we are to model ourselves after is the apostolic church, the church of the first century. And so in these five things we see here, in these verses here, is the first thing is we see the teachings of the apostles. That's the reason why we have a pastor to teach. The second thing we see is the fellowship of the church, and that's the reason why we eat together. After a worship service, we have that social time. The third thing we see is the receiving of communion. And I want to make sure that we understand the theology behind receiving our communion. We need to understand that when we do communion, that we are never here to take. We're not taking communion, but that we are always receiving communion. And so that's something that I'll talk more about later down the road, but I want us to remember that we're always here to receive communion. The fourth thing we see here is prayer. There's prayer in there. And then the fifth thing we see here is offering. Now, this is the biblical basis of the Christian liturgy. Now, is there a historical basis? Yes, well, Justin Martyr, who was a Christian apologist, who lived during the second century, he wrote in 153 AD in his book or letter, First Apology to the Romans. And it's a long quote here, so bear with me. But this is what he wrote. He says, on the day called Sunday, there is a gathering together in the same place of all who live in a given city or a rural district. The memoirs of the apostles or the writings of the prophets are read. Then the reader ceases. The president in the discourse admonishes and urges the imitation of these good things. Next, we rise together and send up prayers. When we cease from our prayer, bread is presented and wine and water. The president in the same manner sends up prayers and thanksgiving according to his ability. And the people sing out their assent, saying the amen. A distribution and participation of the elements for which thanks have been given is made to each person. And to those who are not present, they are sent by the deacons. Those who have means and are willing, each according to his own choice, gives what he wills, and what is collected is deposited with the president. He provides for the orphans and the widows, those who are in need on account of sickness or some other cause, those who are in bonds, strangers, and in a word, he becomes the protector of all who are in need, end quote. And so just reading from the writings of Justin Martyr, we see that there's also five things during the early church. The first thing is the teachings of the Word of God. There was the teaching. The second thing is the fellowship of the church. The third thing is the receiving of communion. The fourth thing is prayer. And the fifth thing is offering. So they're following the exact same patterns that the apostles followed in the New Testament and the book of Acts. We also see something here in what Martyr wrote about was that when after they received the elements of communion, those who were not present, that the church would take those elements and they would bring it to those people who were not able to attend on that day. I know we don't do that nowadays, but that's what they used to do in the old days. And so by just reading these passages and reading the writings, the historical writings here, we see that our liturgy in the church is not something that was made up. It's not something that's not important, it's not something that's not essential to the church, but it has its root in the Bible. It has its roots in history, in the historical Christian accounts. And so in our United Methodist Church, our liturgy always starts out with the ministry of the acolytes. And today, last week, I talked about restoring Methodism, rediscovering Methodism. This is something new that we need to do, is to rediscover the reason. Why do we do the things that we do? Why do we have the children bring the light into the sanctuary, into the chapel? I know some people don't like the lighting of the candles. I know a lot of the people in our Hmong ministry, they don't like the lighting of the candles because a lot of them, they would say, you know, that's too Catholic. You guys are practicing what the Catholics practice. But reality is that we're not doing this because the Catholic Church does it. We do not find this basis in the Roman Catholic Church. But the reason why we do these things is because we find the basis in the Bible, and we find the basis in our history. However, I want to also remind us that this does not mean that we are always to do this or that we must do this to be a Christian. The lighting of the candle is not a sacrament, just as any other Protestant Christian church believes, and we believe in the same thing as other Protestant Christian church, that there's only two sacraments. Those two sacraments are things that are sacred that we must do because they are set. They are things that Jesus Christ did, and he has commanded us to do these things. And so those two sacraments in the Protestant church and in the United Methodist church are the same thing. It is baptism. And do you know what the other one is? Communion, yes. So baptism and communion. Now, in the Catholic Church, do you know how many sacraments they have? They have 7 sacraments as compared to our church, to the Protestant Christian churches. So we don't have 2 sacraments. So we don't see this lighting of candle as a sacrament, but yet it is something we do, not because we must do it, but we do it because it's part of our history. It's part of our Christian history, and there is a basis for it from the scripture. Now, the biblical basis is found also in Exodus chapter 27, verse 20 through verse 21, which Alma read for us earlier today. And this is what it reads. I want to read it again from the NIV version. It says, "Command the Israelites to bring you clear oil of pressed olives for the light, so that the lamps may be kept burning in the tent of meeting outside the curtain that shields the Ark of Covenant of the covenant law. Aaron and his sons are to keep the lamps burning before the Lord from evening till morning. This is to be a lasting ordinance among the Israelites for the generations to come." And so basically what God is saying to Moses and to the Israelites here in these verses is that God is telling them that at nighttime, when there is darkness outside, that they are to keep the lamps, they are to keep the light inside that tabernacle lit. So it must always be burning throughout the night. And the reason for that, the reason that God commanded them to do that, was because it is a reminder to them that the light of God is always with them through the darkness. Through the darkest moments in their lives, through the darkest moments of their history, that the light of God is always with them. And that's the whole purpose. That's the whole purpose of lighting that light or lighting the lamps here through the evening till morning. It is that reminder. It is that reminder that God is being with them. And so that leads us into the New Testament. It leads us into the New Testament. And of course, we know the New Testament is written based off of the Old Testament. And so when the New Testament, John wrote in John chapter 1, verse 9, he says that that true light that gives light to everyone was coming to the world. And so the real lights, because those lamps inside that tabernacle, inside that tent of meeting, that light was only a shadow of the true light. And in the New Testament, we see that true light. We see the reality of that true light. And the reality of that true light is Jesus Christ. That Christ is the light of the world. That he came into the world. He came into the darkness to give us sight so that we can see. To give us light so that we can see the world for the way that it truly is. And so the reason why we light that candle, the reason why we light that candle at the beginning of our worship service, is because the lighting of that candle is a reminder to the church that Jesus Christ is always, always, always with us. And so we are confirming the promise given to us in the Great Commission. The Great Commission, which is given, Jesus Christ gave to us in Matthew chapter 28, verse 20. When at the end of the Great Commission, you know, after Jesus told the disciples that they are to go and make disciples and to baptize them and to teach them, Jesus Christ ends that Great Commission by saying, "I am with you always to the very end of the age." And that's why we light the candle. We light the candle to remind us of that. We light the candle to remind us where Jesus Christ is. Now, I also want to ask you a question, because I know that, Mormon churches, right? They go and they build all these temples. They build all these temples. But is the church building the same thing as the temple? Is the church building the same thing as the tabernacle of the Old Testament? Because in the Old Testament, we have the tent for the meeting or the tabernacle. And during the time of Solomon, it was replaced by the Jerusalem temple. Nowadays, many times, we often think of the church as that temple. But the church is not that temple. Because the scripture tells us that the real temple is Jesus Christ. Because the tent, because the temple, they're all just shadows of the real temple, which is Jesus Christ. And so the tabernacle was given and the temple was given to remind the Israelites of God's presence. Nowadays, Jesus is that reminder for us of God's presence. And that when we are in Christ, then we become that temple. We become that temple. It is not the church building that is the temple, but it is us as Christians. That's why Jesus says, where two or three of you are gathered, that I am there with you. That's why Jesus says that it is not at Jerusalem, it's no longer at Jerusalem where you're going to worship, but when you worship, you're going to worship in truth and in spirit. And so Jesus is saying that the place in which you're at doesn't matter. But wherever you are at, then that is where the temple is at. That is where the presence of God is at. So as Christians, we can worship by the river. As Christians, we can worship at the park. As Christians, we can worship outside. As a Christian, we can worship anywhere. And Christ will always be there with us. We don't have to go to the temple anymore. We don't have this tabernacle that we need to go to anymore. We don't even need to be here to worship on Sundays. We can go anywhere, and as long as two or three of us are together, there Christ is at. And there we can light the candle to remind ourselves of the presence of Jesus Christ. And that's the whole point of the ministry of the Acolytes. And so when we think about things in this way, from this theological standpoint, we see that the children are very, very important. They are a very, very important part of the ministry of the church. They're a very important part of us. When we go to many churches, sometimes we don't see children at all participating in the worship service. But here in the United Methodist Church, we encourage our children. We encourage our children to take part of this worship service. And so those two candles up there, they represent Christ's two nature. One nature, God, he's fully God. Another nature, he is fully man. And so sometimes people ask me about the procession order. How are we going to do, you know, when we walk in, what is the procession order? Because sometimes people say, well, you know, I see some pastors, when they do this, they go stand up there in the front or by the pulpit, and they wait for the children to come in. Sometimes I see pastors and they're following the children. What is the correct procession order? Well, I mean, we can do it any way we want. There's no law or anything like that to say that if you do this, then you can't be a Christian anymore. There's no law towards that. But yet, at the same time, there is a correct procession order. And so the question that we need to ask ourselves is this. Because our procession order represents the order in the church. So the question we need to ask ourselves is this. Do the pastor go before Christ, or do Christ go before the pastor? What do you guys think? Christ always goes first. So Jesus Christ always goes first, and then the pastor follows Jesus Christ. That's how we lead in the church. The pastor is never to go ahead of Christ. None of the leaders in the church are ever to go ahead of Christ. So Christ is always to go first. So the correct procession order is that the candle does go first, and then the pastor and, you know, the liturgist or whoever can participate at that time, they will follow that. Because in the church, Christ always goes first. And so as we approach the altar, we would the children would bow, and then they would light the gospel candle, which is on the right. They will light the right, and then they will light the left. And as we end the worship service and we come to extinguish the candles, we are to extinguish the left. We go the opposite direction. We are to extinguish the left and then the right. Because the gospel candle, which is on the right, is never to go out first. Okay, so we always need to remember that. So we light from the right and then to the left. And then when we extinguish from the left and then to the right. And then as we close out our worship service, the light is brought out into the world, once again reminding us of the Great Commission. In reality, our worship service never ends. Now, if we were to talk about this from a theological standpoint, from a theological standpoint, we by saying that the worship service ends, it will actually be incorrect. Okay, if you were to say something like that in seminary, you know, you'll be incorrect. But what we say is that we just say that the worship service closes, because our worship never ends. Because as the light is going out into the world, it represents for us that we too are to follow that light, to follow Jesus Christ out into the world, and to be that light into the world, to make disciples of Jesus Christ out in the world, to lead people to Christ out in the world, to be examples, to be like the Apostle Paul says, we are ambassadors of Christ to the world. So we're to speak for Christ, we are to be an example of Christ to the world. We are to lead people to Jesus Christ. And that's the whole reason why we bring the light out. And as we follow that light, that's something that we always need to remember. That we're not just simply following this child that's carrying this light, but we're following this child because we're going to bring the light of Christ out into the world. And so that's the whole point of us closing out our worship service. Now, why do we use children? Well, we use children because there is a biblical basis for that. We see in Samuel chapter 3, verse 1, we see the young Samuel, who was a boy at that time. Scholar says he's no more than 12 years old. He's ministering before the Lord under Eli. It's a long story, so I'm not going to read that, but you can go ahead and read in Samuel chapter 3 if you want to. We also see throughout the scripture, we see children serving the Lord under the priest, and it was a way for them to be prepared for their own calling. And so the word acolyte here actually means a follower or a helper, someone who's there to assist the priest, to assist the pastors. And in Matthew chapter 19, verse 14, Jesus says, of course we read this earlier, Jesus says, let the children come to me. Do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these. And so in the United Methodist Church, we do everything that we can to bring our children to Jesus Christ. We do everything that we can. And I was just talking to my brother the other day, and I was telling him that, you know, I basically grew up in the church. I grew up doing things in the church, and that played a big role in my faith. But many of my friends, many of the people that I knew when we were kids, and you know, even though they were Christians, they never really cared about the church. Many of them, they would care more about partying on Friday nights, partying on Saturdays, and things like that. And nowadays, as we're approaching our 50s, they're still doing that very same thing. They're still partying on Friday nights because they're accustomed to that. They're used to doing that. So they're still partying on Friday nights. Saturdays, they're still partying, you know, using all their time to do that. But yet, because I grew up in the church, I'm so accustomed to going to church. I was telling one of the young Hmong ladies the other night, I was telling her that, you know, I would not know what to do if I don't go to church. I would be lost, you know. I would be lost. I would have nothing to do, you know. I'll probably go crazy or something like that. I'll go insane or something like that if I don't go to church. And that's the reason why it's so important for us to do ministry for our children. We need to do ministry for them. We need to find things for them to do within the church, you know. I took some pictures. My wife and I spent time with the Marysville youth yesterday. And when we got there, the youth was all spread out, you know. The youth was all spread out. And we spent the last couple of years just gathering everybody and bringing everybody together to bring the youth back together. And now we have probably about 20 to 30 youth there at that church. And it's been more difficult here in our Oroville church, bringing the youth together. It's been a more, don't know what the reason is, but it's been a more difficult task. But in Marysville, we're able to bring everybody together, right? We're able to bring more people together for that reason. And so these are the things that we really need to do, is to bring our children to Christ. And part of that bringing them to Christ is to have them serve in the church. And being an acolyte is something that they can do in the church. It is something, a ministry that they can do in the church. Now in the United Methodist Church, there is a process in which we're supposed to train them. There's a process in which we're supposed to confirm them. And hopefully, maybe down the road, maybe we can do something like that so that they can feel more like this is something important for them, right? But in the Methodist Church, we do have those confirmation services and things like that just to confirm them in that position of being an acolyte in the church. But Matthew chapter 18, verse 3 also says this. Jesus also says this. Jesus says, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of God. So you see, Jesus is telling us in Matthew chapter 19 that we're to bring children to him. We must not hinder them. But the chapter before that, Jesus is also telling us that they are the model for us. That the children are the model for us, that if we want to enter the kingdom of heaven, then we must be like them. They're still in that state of purity. They're not like us. They don't have grudges yet, right? Many of us, we have grudges with somebody. You know, maybe you have grudges with your brother or sister. I don't know. We still have grudges. We have anger. We have issues, right? As adults, we have issues. Okay, let's just put it that way. We have issues. And many of our children have yet to have that issue. And so they're, you know, children are, when I watch children play together, I see that these kids, they can forgive each other quickly. They can fight over a piece of toy, they can fight over a piece of candy, and they'll fight over that for 20, 30 minutes, and then after that, they forget about it. 10 minutes after that, they can come back and play together again. And sometimes when I look at our church members, you know, the people in our church, the adults in our church, it's so difficult for us to do that. We'll have a disagreement, and we'll hold on to that for years and years and years and years and years, right? And so that's the reason why Jesus is saying here that the children, they're that example for you. That you need to be like children, right? So Jesus is setting them up as that example for us, their purity as children for us. And that is the reason why we have them carry the light of Christ into the chapel. That does not mean that adults can't do it. Of course, adults can do it also, but we encourage children to do it. Because they are that example and they carry that light into the church to remind us that Jesus Christ is now here. So before we do anything in our Methodist worship, we're always reminding ourselves that Christ is with us, that Jesus Christ is with us. Now another historical basis for us, that we see that in the 3rd century, the acolytes, they also helped deacons set up the communion table. So they were not just there just to light the candle or anything like that, but they were there to help the deacons set up the communion table. We read about what Martyr was talking about delivering the elements to those who were not present. Children also took part of that. Not only did the deacons go out to do that, but there were children that were helping the deacons deliver these elements to those people who were not present. And so we see the importance of the children in our church, the importance of the children in our ministry. That's what we do. Like I said, we do everything that we can as Methodists to encourage our children to be a part of our ministry. I know sometimes children, when they sit in here, they can be loud. I know they can be noisy and things like that. But we do everything that we can to try to encourage them. And of course, in the late Middle Ages, where when we started using candles from that time on, and at that time we were not separated from the Catholic Church yet, we're still together. And during that time, we started having them assist in the lighting of the candle. And most the reason for that was kind of started out with just lighting the candle so the priest or whoever's leading the service can read from the scripture. And that's the history of our acolytes. And so I just want to remind us that acolytes, they are the helpers in the church. They are our children in the church. And they do more than just light the candles. They often help with setting up communion. They often help with other items for worship service. We also have a confirmation service that we provide for our children as they become acolytes and as they serve in this ministry. And that we have both a biblical basis and a historical basis for the things that we do. We're not simply just copying the Catholics. We're not trying to be Catholics here. We're doing what the Bible says and what has been part of our history. And so our worship service in the United Methodist Church always starts out with that reminder of Jesus' presence, that he is here with us, confirming the promise that was given to us in the Great Commission. And also our worship service closes. It closes with that reminder that today, that our worship service does not end here, but that we are to go out into the world and to bring that light into the world. And that's why Romans chapter 12, verse 1 says that true worship is to offer our bodies everything that we have for God. Offer everything, all every moment, every breath that we take, you know, everything that we do is to be offered up to God. and that we use children because they are that example for us. We are to be like children if we are to enter into heaven. Now let us pray together. Lord, we thank you so much for blessing our church. We have so many children here in our church. This morning, there's about 20, 30 of them that showed up here for our church. And Lord, we're just so blessed to have them. We ask that you continue to be with us. Continue to just bless us as we encourage them into the service, as we encourage them to serve in your church and also to take part of our worship service here, Lord. We thank you so much. We thank you for each other. We pray in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And at this time, it is time for us to do our offering. Please stand. Let us pray. Lord, we come before you to give you thanks for your love and for your blessings upon our lives, Lord. As we come to worship you, we also bring you these tithes and these offerings for the sake of your name, for the sake of your kingdom. We ask that you pour your blessings upon these. Use it for the sake of your gospel, to spread the good news of the gospel of your Son, Jesus Christ, to all the people of this earth, Lord, until the day in which Jesus Christ returns. We give you thanks in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Please turn your hymnals to 206. 206, I want to walk as a child of the light. May the Lord bless you all. You may be seated at this time. May our Lord Jesus Christ continue to shine upon you as you go out into the world to be the light of Christ. God bless.